So the purpose of this project is to use lasers for cleaning dirt and rust from the surfaces of Sydney Harbour Bridge.
That's like the most iconic building in Australia. It's amazing. So when you're like an international student and you come here and it's just like the fireworks at night you see, so that's amazing to be actually part of restoring this bridge.
The strange thing is you go up there and you stop looking at the view and you really start to appreciate the engineering in the bridge. The historical connection with the engineers of the past who spent so much time trying to work out how to make this thing work. And we're now like the caretakers who've got to carry it forward for the next set of generations to marvel at. So it's a really satisfying and pleasurable thing to do.
Together with the Sydney Harbour Bridge maintenance team and the bridge engineers, we carry out huge responsibility to preserve this magnificent Sydney Harbour Bridge and to maintain its operations for many generations to come.
I'm a heritage person, which makes me a bit different to the other guys on this team. I'm really interested in what this bridge means to the city of Sydney, but also to the rest of Australia, and in some senses to the world. And it's really important that Australians feel that their bridge is being well looked after, but also maintaining those values that it has held for Australians. We want it to keep holding those values for the next 100 or 500 years.
One of the primary maintenance activities on the bridge involves removing of multiple coats of paint and rust to bare steel and repainting it back to a prime condition. That is happening with all accessible and inaccessible areas of the bridge. For example, the tunnels, the 7.2 kilometers tunnels of the bridge courts, inaccessible area. This project will lead to a protocol for a laser technology to remove paint and dust from steel and a granite structure, not only for the Sydney Harbour Bridge, for the all different structures within Transport of New South Wales.
The main driver for Transport for New South Wales in this project is to adapt laser ablation on heritage steel.
We are using grit blasting operation to clean lead paint and rust from the bridge. This process is not an environmentally friendly operation.
The issue we have is it's creating a lot of dust and hazardous waste as well.
The innovative study is in order to reduce containment, eliminate media, improve safety to workers in confined spaces and adapt disposable systems. When these activities are performed with the robots, they will provide a formidable combination in maintenance and structural intervention with the protection to workers and environment.
The surfaces which you see outside, they are reasonably in a good shape and a good condition. The problem is with the internal surfaces of the channels the bridge is built of. The length of the channels is about 7.2 kilometers. The bridge has about 6 million rivets, and rivets are made of different kind of steel, so there could be some corrosion between the rivets and the main construction of the bridge. So it's a huge job.
The problem with the channels is that they are relatively small and non-human passable. So they're about 900 by 500 millimeters internally, three to each arch. Every 9 meters there is a separation plate that it's very hard for humans to get through. The standard method for cleaning paint is to use sandblasting. And in such an enclosed space, the sand and the dust has nowhere really to go, and you just can't see what's going on. So it's basically impossible to methodically go and clean off the paint and the corrosion and know what's happening.
So we are looking for autonomous solution to clean the bridge. So we need to build a robot with we'll have the laser head on top of it, so we can crawl on the bridge and clean every part of the bridge and even the difficult area.
We have been working together with Roads and Maritime Services of RMS for over 16 years. We have developed many robots, for example, the blasting robot, the climbing robot, and then this one, four-legged robot. people are not encouraged to work in confined space because of the safety concern. Second thing is because of the maintenance operation, like sandblasting or grit blasting, which is very noisy and the dusty environment, which is really not good for people. From the robot point of view, in order to have a machine which can really operate in the confined space, the robot has to have enough intelligence. Or that's what we call we need autonomous robot. And the robot can get into the confined space, use the sensor to sense the environment around, to get enough knowledge of the environment, and then decide what to do. Okay, so this is the camera, and this is the laser, and this is the tool. The cleaning tool, or the painting tool, or the vacuum tool will be attached here. This is the robot arm, and those are the four legs of the robot.
To remove the paint, conventionally we used sandblasting and or scrubbing, but this is very invasive technology. So we are looking to remove a paint without any interruption to the base metal. This is critical because we want this icon to sustain and be as beautiful for the next 100 years and more probably.
In independent pilot projects, Transport identified commercial lasers in Europe and US and carried out laser ablation of heritage steel components. The post-processing of the laser ablated steel was carried out at ANSTO and USIT to determine if the effects of commercial lasering on steel was detrimental. Advanced FEA studies were carried out in-house. Not satisfied with the test results, and after a literature review, we identified the need to outline a project involving laser physicists at ANU. The main aim of this project was to develop a safe protocol for the ablation of paint and rust in steel. The project was then expanded to include removal of dirt from granite with the University of Canberra.
We use very short pulses. Such pulses do not provide heat, so you can remove paint without heating underlying surface.
We are using light to remove material on the surface of the steel, so we call it ablation. We hit the dust with light and it's vaporized, and then we collect it with a vacuum pump.
This new generation of laser uses femtosecond laser pulses. This means that they are ultra short, they are just a millionth of a billionth of a second long. These ultra short pulses, they let us ablate the material with no heat introduced into the steel, for example. That means we are in a cold ablation regime, and this means there's less energy wasted and we can have a very effective process. So this is the original bridge with the paint on it, and when we laser clean it, this is how the result looks like. So the process that we develop here, I try to use that to texture surfaces and then bond the paint or like polymers to the steel so we can ultimately repaint the bridge in the end. Paint is different to any other material, so you need to engineer it for every material specifically. So, and that's what we can do with this laser, because we can control it very precisely and do it whatever the needs are.
So the arches on the Harbour Bridge are made of a very special steel that's very high in silicon. It's not made anymore today because it's quite expensive. It's quite a lot stronger than standard steel. But it's extremely hard to get hold of this material, and it's probably fair to say that it's actually rarer than gold. So we have none of that whatsoever to work with. So that's one challenge in trying to understand the interaction of the laser with the steel. So we use this machine to measure both the depth that we ablate in the material and also the surface roughness and the edge profiles. So this machine is something called a white light interferometer, and what it does is to form a 3D image of the surface of a sample. And so it can do this with exquisite sensitivity and quite quickly, so that we're able to take samples directly off the machine in the lab, come up here, and in 3 minutes we've got an answer as to what we just did in the lab. And that allows us this nice feedback to understand much better what's going on and try to tune things in more quickly.
We change the microstructures with the laser. We can target specifically like the width of the beam. We can like change the depth of the beam, so we can draw any pattern that you might want to onto a surface. You can like do round dimples, you can do grooves, you can do, I don't know, chest patterns, yeah, whatever you want. So we try to increase the bonding strength, and therefore we found that grooves are the best because it is in alignment with the scanning process and with the bonding testing. The width is like about between 50 and 100 micrometer wide, and the depth varies between 30 to 100 micrometer.
The team at the University of Sydney was looking at the changes in macrostructure and property on the steel after the laser treatment to remove the layer of paint and oxide. We can go through different physical processes, phase transformation that include going to melting or even evaporation. And if we go to melting, then when the temperature is removed, we're going to have a cool down and a change in the macrostructure is going to happen, which can affect the material property of the component, the entire component. This is steel from the Harbour Bridge. These different squares have been actually laser ablated using different parameters such as the intensity of the laser or the number of pass or time the square was scanned by the laser. There is different surface finish for the different parameters that have been used. So we do cross-section of the material. And so we're looking, so if this is the surface that has been treated, we're going to look in the cross-section and see if we have changes that are happening from the top to the core of the material. So if there is a gradient of grain size or a gradient of chemical distribution.
At AMSTO, we have these unique capabilities to measure stresses within the components fully non-destructively. So we're using neutron measurements and X-ray measurements on the surface to help understand the residual stress profile critical for this project.
So my role in the cleaning of the bridge is to look at the granite. I worked previously with Andre before looking at the use of lasers to clean heritage materials, and so he brought me on board to look at this very big heritage object.
The granite on the bridge is not part of the structure. It doesn't hold the bridge. It's just an aesthetic part of the bridge. The pylons are not holding the bridge. They're just here for making it aesthetically balanced.
So the granite is from Maria, which is down on the south coast of Australia, and there's a quarry down there which was given to the bridge, given for the bridge. And so it all comes from that one place. It's beautiful, beautiful stone. They really took the best of the quarry, which is why it still looks so fabulous today. Some areas that have quite a lot of staining. So they have what we think is biological staining, which is quite dark and black. There's some areas where there's corrosion that's coming from corroding iron in parts of the armature, and then there's some general dirt on it. But a lot of it actually doesn't look that dirty. And so we've really got to ask the question, in those areas, is it better to clean or not to clean? Could we cause more damage if we clean? Any cleaning method can damage the substrate that you're working on. Any cleaning method needs to be done carefully and not too invasively, and that goes for all the treatments that have been used on the bridge today, which can include, you know, air abrasive blasting or water washing or even some use of acids for poulticing. Lasers are just one of those available treatments, and we're looking to see whether they can be more subtle and less invasive than the other ones that have been tried.
So we are looking at the highest energy that we can apply without removing material from the surface. And it's a difficult aspect because our granite is a complex material. As you can see, it is a polymineralic stone, which means there are a lot of different minerals. There's quartz, which is grey, there's biotite and hornblende, which are the black minerals, and there's feldspar, several types of feldspar, which are the white ones. They all react differently because they have different properties, chemical, physical properties, electrical, optical. So what we have been doing is focusing on the black minerals because they are the most sensitive ones, and the other ones are less sensitive, so they just go very well along.
So during this project, we put a lot of effort into the testing of the materials after they've been exposed to the laser using pretty much every technique we could think of and lay our hands on. And we've developed a process that doesn't seem to damage either the bridge steel or the granite itself, and that's a really important outcome. The project now is at the phase where we're looking to move towards deployment, the world's first portable femtosecond laser cleaning system. And we're looking to partner again with Transport for New South Wales in developing that system. This is quite a large engineering challenge, primarily because femtosecond lasers so far have not been designed to go into the field. There's an issue with the operating environment. Yeah, you know, top of the bridge could be 40 degrees air temperature, high humidity, solar radiation coming down as well. The laser was never designed to operate in that environment. So we've got to figure out how you stabilize it, isolate it, how you deliver the beam. The laser itself is not actually on the robotic device itself, and so we have to find a means to deliver the laser beam from the gantry where the laser is mounted, and we then have to feed it down to the cleaning head on the front of the robot and find a way to do that that's stable, has very low attenuation and is safe for operators. So there's an interesting challenge because at some points on the bridge you may have to drop 50 meters from the gantry down to the lower arch and then go into the arch. And this is not a solved technology today, and is a problem we're going to be working on for a little while, I suspect.
I think that there should be several robots. One robot is cleaning, another robot is sucking all the stuff which was cleaned, and the third one is putting some layers of paint. So they could go one after another. 10 kilowatt level lasers would do the job in 3-5 years. But they have to work 24 hours a day.
I really enjoy the fact that we're applying the lasers on heritage materials. I think that's pretty cool.
Oh, it's really entertaining to be part of this project and to clean the bridge and doing an amazing thing here for Australia and with a strong impact for every bridge in the world. So it's not only for, as I'm a French citizen, I'm doing this for every world heritage in the world.
So I think this project, it's been very enjoyable to work on, both from the scientific perspective, the heritage perspective, and I guess understanding the engineering of the past that we're trying to respect and preserve. It's taken a lot of time and a lot of effort. We've learned a lot of interesting things, and we've seen the field develop its technology during the time that we've been doing this. It's very much an evolving game, and that really makes it exciting to be at the forefront of this.